Hello, my name is Erwin Van Meir. I'm a researcher here in the Department of Neurosurgery and the Winship Cancer Institute. My laboratory has been working for many years on brain tumors, and especially on a molecule called brain angiogenesis inhibitor 1, or BI1 for short. Well, recently we have discovered that this molecule is also very important for spatial learning and memory, showing that sometimes a discovery in one area of research leads to discoveries in another one. So here is our protein of interest. It's called brain angiogenesis inhibitor 1, BI1 for short. And you can see it's embedded in the cell membrane with seven transmembrane domain, a large piece that's extracellular, and a piece that goes inside. So we decided to build what we call a knockout mouse. That means a mouse that is missing the gene of interest, in this case BI1. And then we can see that indeed these mice are missing the protein BI1. Because BI1 is expressed at very high levels in the brain, including in neurons, we hypothesized that perhaps it played an important role in brain function. And one of the tests that is being used in research is what is called the Morris water maze. It consists of a little kiddie pool here that's filled with water that's the color of milk, so it's not transparent. And then a mouse is dropped in the pool and has to randomly swim until it finds a hidden platform. Every day the mouse will get a little bit better at finding the hidden platform because it will remember where it is located in relation to the visual cues. This is a wild-type mouse, this is a knockout mouse. The wild-type mouse will swim and rapidly focus on this area because it remembers where the platform is, whereas the knockout mouse is still swimming about anywhere to find it. The wild-type animal spends most of its time in the quadrant where the platform used to be, whereas the knockout mouse is still swimming randomly, suggesting that it did not acquire any spatial memory of where the platform used to be. And so it was particularly interesting to us to then see if this inability of the mice to learn was linked to something abnormal in the neurons in the hippocampus.
And one way that we can probe the hippocampus to see how spatial memory is occurring is to look at a process called long-term potentiation. And with long-term potentiation, what you do is you look at a signal coming into a neuron or a group of neurons, and then you stimulate that neuron as though it would when it was activated trying to find the platform. And you look to see if the response of the neurons changes, either increasing in response or decreasing in response. An increase in response is long-term potentiation. A decrease in response is long-term depression. So what we have is the cell's ability to produce long-term potentiation and long-term depression. What's really interesting is in the BAI1 knockout mice is that when we do the 5x stimulation is that you get this prolonged enhancement of the signal following the stimulation. Whereas normally it would decline, it's continuing to increase. So we've got a very specific enhancement of long-term potentiation. But what's equally interesting is that when we do the low frequency stimulation in the BAI1 knockout mice, what we now found is that instead of long-term depression, we get a long-term potentiation. Now, normally you would associate long-term potentiation with better memory. But what this is suggesting is that it's a balance between long-term depression and long-term potentiation that allows you to form the memory. And that if you change one or the other in any direction, that is going to cause problems with the selectivity of memory formation.
The hippocampus is a brain region that is very important for learning and memory. So what you see on this electron micrograph is a spine, so this is called SP here, so that's the spine, and this spine is connected with an axon terminal labeled T here. The relationship between the two, the communication between the two is happening at this junction here that we call the synapse. At this synapse, you can see on the side of the spine, you can see this very dark area here that we call the postsynaptic density. So the postsynaptic density is made up of a large number of proteins, including PSD95, that aggregates here, and these proteins are very important to mediate the communication between this terminal and that neuron. You can see here on these micrographs, you can see that is very dark here, very long, very dark material, whereas in the knockout animal, it is much paler and much thinner. We found that the thickness of the postsynaptic density was reduced in the knockout animal compared to control.
And the reason for this reduction is that the protein is much less stable in the knockout than in the wild-type brain. And BY1 is able to prevent this from happening. So here, this is an experiment now in 293 neuronal cells. You see the polyubiquitination of PSD95, and you bring BY1 here by transfection, and this is completely prevented. And this is because the E3 ubiquitin ligase MDM2 can normally degrade PSD95. So next we wondered whether we could in some way help restore the function of these neurons in the hippocampus of these BY1 mice, BY1 knockout mice, and to this effect we designed a viral therapy. We designed an adeno-associated virus that can re-express PSD95, trying to restore the protein in the brain. So we produced virus, and the virus gets injected stereotactically straight in the hippocampus. And the next step then is to measure the electrical response of these neurons using a patch clamp experiment. And as you can see here, in the knockout mice, we have an abnormal LTP under the low frequency stimulation. And in the neurons that now have been transduced with PSD95, we can restore a normal LTD, as you can see here. So simply putting back PSD95 in the knockout mice neurons was able to fix the abnormal electrical signals in these neurons. This inability to learn spatial cues is something that is found in several neurological diseases in patients. And so if we have a better idea of how all the signals work normally and what can really disturb this normal signaling, then we can possibly use that knowledge to devise further therapies that will help patients who have neurological diseases. It was very important for us to be able to reach out to collaborators on campus who have expertise different than ours, so that we could do electron microscopy, we could do electrophysiology, we could do behavioral research. And so by bringing all this expertise together, this is really how we were able to find the clues as to how this protein is working in the brain.